mounds of shrooms and stare at the sky. And when the clouds form your guys' faces, I wonder to myself, why am I being tortured like this?
It's a show by Chris and Neil with all great movies. They are the real deal. We watch them all, so you don't have to. It's movies that don't suck and some that do.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, listeners of all ages, welcome to the newest, the cleanest, the most prestige episode of Movies That Don't Suck and Some That Do. My name is Neil.
And I'm Chris.
I'm Mark.
I'm glad you remembered your line.
Yeah, Mark's here too, but you forgot your line?
The fuck are you talking to?
Yeah, who are you talking to?
Chris, he just forgot his line. How long did it take him to say, am I delayed that
Yes,
bad?
You're delayed.
Gosh dang it, guys. We just started the episode. How are we delayed so quickly? All right, give me 5 seconds. Everybody, hey, all six people of you watching. One second, I'll be right back.
I'll talk to Mark while you're gone.
No. Yeah, you guys talk. Have fun. You guys touch each other in the no-no spots. That's like, funny. Literally, I've already hit refresh, and it's taking forever.
Okay. So, have you heard Borderlands sucks?
Yeah, dude. Like, I saw the, right now it's at 7%. That's lower than the Madam Web is. So...
That's up from zero.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It was a zero this morning. I begged Neil not for us to see it. So we're...
You know who wants... So Alexis wants to review Cuckoo, and I currently don't have it on my schedule. I've got Borderlands Monday, then Aliens, and then I think...
Chris doesn't allow me to pick movies anymore.
No, I told him that we can't see Borderlands.
And then The Crow. So I have no time at all to see Cuckoo, but she's interested, and I told her to hit you guys up. So
we are seeing Cuckoo, but we're also seeing The Crow. So,
Okay.
Crow come out this weekend?
No, it comes out two weeks from
Crow
now.
Crow comes out at the end of the month.
Yeah.
Okay, I was going to say, if it comes out this weekend.
This weekend's Borderlands, the next weekend is Alien Romulus, and then The Crow.
We are definitely, we're doing Alien Romulus.
You can't see it because of how high and low the camera is. Literally, one of my favorite art pieces is right behind me, and it is literally, I have had conversations with James O'Barr. I'm a huge, huge Crow fan. I wanted to get a tattoo of, like, the Crow that says it can't rain all the time. Then my friend Logan went and got it, like, a couple months ago. I was like, well, I can't get it now. It looks like we're dating.
I have questions. Have you ever read the comic?
I have them all autographed.
Okay, so years ago, on Long Road to Ruin, Sean and I did all four Crow movies, and we used to have a guy who did personalized title card art for us.
And the TV show, too?
No, we only did the movies. So Benjamin J. Cologne, who is Benjamin J. Cologne on all his things, if you want to check out his artwork, he used to do title card art for us, and he actually did one, I believe, of the Crow. So he would put us in the title card art as, like, part of the character. So, like, if we were doing Terminator, we were in there with Arnold Schwarzenegger, that sort of thing. Some of this stuff's actually up on my TeePublic store. You can buy T-shirts of it.
I have to stop you. Did we do the intro already? And now we're just, like, talking without introducing what movies we're
doing. Oh, sorry, yeah. Okay.
No, we haven't gotten that far yet. We haven't even gotten that far.
Yeah, we haven't even...
Whoops.
All right. Let's go back to this conversation here in a second. We'll talk about it because I'm sure I'll have something newsworthy of the Crow here in a little bit. But anyway, let's get to the movie to the movies, guys. Today we were talking two movies, all chosen by Chris and Mark. I had no choice in
you
either.
You had choice
in
Trap, dude. Come on. You were part of that Trap.
Just give him that look. Just give him that one. Right. We're never gonna get through this if you don't give me the opportunity to gaslight and abuse you. Okay. And that's an easy one. Okay. Just take it. Just lean back and think of anything, Chris.
Just take the L. Okay. All right, but first we got Back to Black. Not Back in Black. Back in Black's AC/DC, which is a good band.
Cut loose! Come loose!
That's a good one. I like that.
What's up? Loose! Get it loose! Get it out of here! All right, we just...
Dirty deeds! Done dirt cheap! Dirty deeds!
Gosh dang it, I'm actually won tens of thousands of dollars with the Bon Scott voice. Daddy deeds!
Yeah,
we'll
see?
Never have I a class high society. God's gift to ballroom notoriety.
I'll send you some videos. Anyway, Back to Black featuring Amy Winehouse, or the story about Amy Winehouse, featuring, I'm going to fuck up all these names. I know it because I didn't look up any of them. Marissa Abdella.
That's good.
Abdella?
So the album's about going back to a black place in my life.
Well, whatever you channeled, it worked. The album's number one around the world, and it's the highest charting album from a British female artist in the US ever.
Yeah, I got some good songs out of it. I don't write songs to be famous, do you know what I mean? I write songs because I don't know what I'd do if I didn't. I've got to make something good out of something bad.
Yeah, that's Marissa Abdella. As Amy Winehouse.
That's, yeah, I had to take the clip directly from the movie because all the other movies and stuff clips I found was her about either saying very, very words I do not want on this podcast or straight up just saying, hey, dude, I will eat your asshole. And like, there's like, that's like all the clips I found.
That's perfect.
Like, she was on some show.
Agent then?
Yeah, like, Amy,
I know you do all the. I know you do want, you know, all the I want to eat your asshole movies, but what if you're Amy Winehouse?
Yeah, right? Also in this movie, Eddie Marson?
Marsa, I think. He's in Marson, so, okay, whatever.
Didn't agree.
Marson, Eddie Marson. I said, you just...
Didn't agree with me.
Oh, that's a shame.
Now, let me tell you something about the education system, Poppy.
Go on in.
The education system produces left brain prisons. Do you know what that means?
I do, actually.
No, well, I'll tell you. The left brain, our brain has two sides, the left brain and the right brain. The left brain, keep going. The left brain is information, data, it's dead. The right brain is individuality, it's where the soul lies. And the education system, it works like this. I will give you a worldview. Right. And if you repeat my worldview, if you reconfirm my worldview, you will pass your exams and you will go higher and higher and higher and you will become a policeman, a magistrate, a lawyer, a general, a politician, and you will be happy and you will succeed. But if you think for yourself, if you think outside of the box, then you will be unhappy and you will fail. That's how the education system works.
Yeah. Where's that from, Neil? Because I didn't pull it fast enough.
Happy-Go-Lucky, man. Okay. Have you not seen Happy-Go-Lucky? It's
not.
A 2008 movie.
I've not seen
it. It's seriously, if you've never seen Happy-Go-Lucky, that's right up your alley, dude. I think you would really love that movie. Okay. So write it down, tattoo it on your arm, put it right next to the goat. Also in this movie, Jack O'Connell.
You know, that's how much went fucking poof in a thin air, you dumb shit. So that's how much you owe us, because I'm not the only one watching your show. I'm not the only shareholder who got screwed over here.
The only shareholder here with a gun.
You think you're fucking funny, Lee, huh?
Okay.
It's funny to you?
Lee, don't provoke him.
You must think I'm so stupid. Trying to fucking buy me off. I'm not stupid, Lee. I walked in here knowing there was only one way this show was going to end. I came in here knowing I'm not walking out.
It's from the Money Monster of 2016.
With Money Monster, hey, with the great.
We reviewed that when it came out. Oh, it was so bad.
Nice. Oh, really? Was it? Damn it.
No, yeah, it was like way down.
I didn't see it, but I saw, I didn't see the movie, but I saw that George Clooney was in the clip. So I was like, oh, yeah. Hey, it's George Clooney. Yeah. He doesn't make a bad movie. I guess he did. He made one bad movie.
All right, who else?
I can't name counting. Another bad movie he's ever
we're
been.
Not counting Batman and Robin, huh? or the third Ocean's movie.
Because if you take it like it's the 1960s Batman.
Then oh, yeah, that's been my argument for it, sure.
yeah, that's my argument for it. put it on Bat credit. Anyway, Leslie Manfield was the other one.
Yeah.
Your son's dead. It's understandable you forget. I've never really done raising them, teaching them the right way. That's why I had to bring my boy home. So keep an eye on him. Your boy's perfect now. It's not really fair to compare him and Donnie.
I wouldn't ever compare Donnie to our son.
Yeah. He said, you two don't approve.
So that was from 2020's Let Him Go. I think it had Kevin Costner's in that. And I think it probably made more money than Horizon.
Correct. And that movie was a good movie. I mean, any movie that's not The Phantom Thread is a great movie with her in. All right. Then that is everybody in Back to Black. We're going to talk about that one. Then coming up next, the movie everybody's talking about that isn't Deadpool and Wolverine. Trap, featuring the one, the only, he's so sexy. When you say his name, I swear he appears like he's Joe Hendry. The one and only Josh Hartnett.
Oh, fuck. Hold on 1 second. I don't think I have to. I forgot to upload that one. So, but in the meantime, Allison Pill's in this.
Whoops. You know that signal you used to puppet around your Borg? Well, I used it to slap a fractal lock on the ship's systems. Welcome to the world's biggest paperweight.
I'll scrape that key out of your mind, woman.
Except I'm not an idiot, and I didn't memorize the code. I couldn't stop you, but I could stall you. Turns out this ship can make a hologram from anyone who's ever been on board, including an emergency combat hologram.
How may I be of service?
Now, Josh Hartnett.
I'm just saying. I'm just saying you could have used the newsroom and maybe raised the level of intellectualism.
Picard all the way. Picard is a sexy show.
Two out of three seasons were so bad they should be studied.
They should be studied as bomb ass shit.
I was able to.
So I got a question. How many hours did you work on the podcast?
I got Josh right there now. I got it. I just
want to know because I spent like three, maybe four.
Josh Hartnett in the trap as well
today.
Josh Hartnett.
You know, a friend of mine asked me before I got here. Just when we were all shipping out, he asked me, why are you going to fight somebody else's war? What do y'all think, you're heroes? I didn't know what to say at the time, but if you asked me again, I'd say no. I'd say there's no way in hell. Because nobody asks to be a hero. Sometimes turns out that way.
Okay.
Yeah.
One of the
greatest fucking speeches in any movie, period. Black Hawk Down. Oh, that was sexy.
It's been years since I've seen that. It's a great movie, though.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, it's just as good as Picard, but it's, you know, it may be.
Real quick, was the music behind that? Was that in that scene? Or was that added?
Yeah, it was in that scene.
That music is so awful.
No, that was in the scene. Dude. You're the one that made me watch an Amy Winehouse fucking movie, dude. Talk about.
Oh, my God. Cry me a river, you bitch. Jesus Christ. I didn't realize in the 400 fucking years you guys are doing this podcast, Neil never had to watch a bad movie tonight.
I know. All right, continue on. We got Shalika Shamalama and Ariel.
Shamalama Ding Dong.
Yeah, Shamalama.
How do you say your name?
Shamalan.
All right.
And
then Ariel Donahue are both in the same scene because I had to cut it from the movie because they had nothing to grab.
How y'all doing, my queens and kings?
Dad, this is literally the best day of my life.
It's meant to be.
All right. you got
ready. Did you know M. Night Shyamalan's daughter is a singer?
Now I do.
Did you know that?
I didn't know that until
We talk about the most important thing about her. She has the prettiest hair.
Oh, she does. It's great.
The prettiest hair.
It's great hair.
I don't have hair envy as such.
Neither.
Gorgeous hair.
Also in the movie is Haley Mills.
Hey, you want to come to the commissary and get a popsicle with me? Can you only think about your stomach at a time like this? At a time like what? Don't you feel it? Don't you know what's happening? Don't you find it peculiar that we both look so much alike and have the same birthday? It's just one of those things, isn't it?
So from the Parent Trap, I noticed...
The original 1961 Parent Trap.
I know,
Trap.
But all kids...
I didn't even realize who that was.
All kids in 1961 movies sound the same. They all sound the same.
So help me God, I thought that girl was Millie Bobby Brown.
So I thought... I actually thought...
Right, last, but...
Go ahead. Sorry. I interrupted
No,
you.
Go ahead. I'm guessing I'm off timing again because we keep interrupting.
No, you're not. You guys just keep talking over each other.
That's true. I actually thought that the girl, the little girl in this one, looked a lot like Abigail Breslin when she was young, you know? But that's just
me. Yeah, I can see that too. But yeah, I definitely had to check the cast to make sure that wasn't Millie Bobby Brown.
And last but not least, the person who saved the entire movie, Mr. Jonathan Langdon.
I pretend I'm foreign to get girls.
Ordinary looks, mate, huh?
I pretend I'm foreign to get girls.
Harder than it looks, huh? Harder than it looks, huh? Harder than it looks, mate, huh? Harder than it looks, huh, mate? Harder than it looks, huh? Ordinary looks, mate, huh? Harder than it looks, huh? Harder than it looks, huh, mate? Harder than it looks, mate, huh? Cheers! Harder than it looks, huh, mate? Cheers! Harder than it looks, huh? Cheers!
So he didn't do a very good Midwest accent, but I'm sure that was for comedic effect, whatever.
Yeah, those are all different accents. It says it at the bottom of the video, but it
His name isn't Discount Tyree. What's his face? yeah.
To me,
Dollar Store, fucking little Ren Howery.
Yeah.
Oh,
for a while, I thought Little Ren Howery was a Dollar Store Kevin, a Dollar Store Kevin Hart. Yeah, but
I feel like this is all like. When you know how you dump water on a gremlin and it produces other gremlins, but they're of lesser quality.
Kevin Hart. Right?
I feel like somebody dumped water on Anthony Edwards and, you know, back when he was doing the Transformer movie.
We got to go way back before that, bro. We got to go way back before that. Someone dumped water on Cedric the Entertainer, and then we got Anthony.
I think it's a slightly different thing because here's what I think happened. I think an alien laid an egg inside of Cedric the Entertainer and out popped like Anthony Edwards and a few of these other guys, and they got water on them. Yeah. And that's how we got 107 different mildly funny fat black actors.
Yeah.
Makes sense. Okay. How about at this point, Chris, why don't you tell everybody that's watching and at home listening where they can find us?
Okay. You can find us online at moviesdontsuck.net. We're w2m.net.com. It's w2mismoviesnet.com. You'll find us there, along with a bunch of other really cool podcasts. We're also on Instagram, NTS Podcast. We're on the X, NTS Podcast. We're on YouTube, at Movies Don't Suck Podcast. We're on Patreon, patreon.com/moviesdontsuck. We have Bonfire. Your Bonfire concert, Movies Don't Suck, and something new. You'll find shirts with our name on it. And Neil also has set up a Tee Public in Blackwood Productions, where you can find more stuff if you want to buy stuff. That has our name on it. And where do you find podcasts? Find Movies Don't Suck and something new. Like, subscribe, all that shit. Mark, where can people find you?
I am at Mark Radulich on TikTok. I am also part of the W2M Network, which our landing page is w2mnetwork.com. Our YouTube is W2M Network. However, if you would just like to listen to my podcast and my podcast only in the form in which it was intended, the audio format, you can check out the Radulich in Broadcasting Network on Apple Podcasts or Spotify or wherever you find your favorite podcasts.
Mark, that's how I think that how our show is too. Meant to listen to audio.
this was never meant to be. This whole thing right here.
But it's awesome. Let's just be honest. We have a good time doing this part, and that's just the bottom line. Like, we got viewers that are watching. We got people that love us. Nobody ever puts in the chat, but, you know, that's only because, you know, Who wants to interrupt greatness?
Okay. So,
today we're going to talk about a great place that we're going to help out for our sponsorship is Gamble's Pastrika and Grocery. Thank you for asking, Chris. It's on 1921 South Harvard Street, Tulsa, Oklahoma. Their neighborhood Italian scratch cooking Italian market. Everything is freshly made there, including their own beers they make in-house. It is 100% family owned. They make, you can see right here, them chopping it up, getting it ready. Look at them making the noodles. Look, they're having a good time. Hear that, or on their shrooms. I don't know which way. But they even have a market where you can buy all their homemade pastas, all their made sauces and stuff. They make their own mozzarella. This is what I had yesterday.
That mozzarella looks fucking divine, by the way. Sorry, I know I'm supposed to talk during the segment, but
go ahead.
That mozzarella is predatory and try to take my pants.
Yeah.
I'm gonna screenshot cutlet and jerk off to that later. That's amazing.
This cutlet right here, yeah. You can't see how big that bowl is, but that cutlet, like, seriously, I could only eat the cutlet. Like two bites of the pasta.
I was gonna say, size of a human fucking liver.
Yeah, it's like ginormous.
Oh my god, look at that pesto. That is so green. Look at that.
Yeah, this is all handmade too, and it's just a little shop right down the road. This is there. I told him this is not Chicago. This is a deep dish. There's a difference, and he agreed with me.
That'll also fucking block your colon for an hour. Jesus. Yeah.
Like, well, all their food looks great. Look at their lasagna.
Oh god. Oh. No, wait. Go back one.
Oh, which one?
That's
their cutlets.
What is that sauce?
That is, I believe correctly, that is their white sauce, their Alfredo sauce.
This is on top. Yo,
I'm going to need you to go in there and get me some of this and put it in an envelope and mail it to me.
Look at this. Oh,
that is very nice looking.
Yeah. So it is Gamble's palette. Guys, if you ever come to Tulsa, you can find their stuff on TulsaPasta.com, or you can just go to the location. It's Gamble's Pastrisa and Grocery, and I'm telling you, these guys are the best. The first day that they opened up, me and my friend Topher went in there. They made us a whole, like, we're the only people in there, and they're like, we'll just let you sample the entire menu. And the guy that owns it literally just brought out bowls and bowls of pasta. And we're just like,
how much of a fat ass am I if I just moved to Tulsa just for the food you keep advertising?
I know, right? Or just come here a week. I got a bed right here. Like, right here, there's a full
considering the way
bed.
My life is going, I might just take you. I told you, I might just take you up on that.
We're fine. We're seriously okay with it. My wife is cool with it. But anyway, anybody that's Gamble's Pasta Rica, look them up at Gamble Pasta at Facebook. All right.
Put some in an envelope and mail it to me, please.
You're going to take the cannoli, right? Okay. You guys ready to talk about...
they got cannolis, too. I just didn't upload them. Yeah.
That's what I said.
They got cheesecake. That the piece is like that fucking big. And like that.
Do they have rainbow cookies the size of actual rainbows?
Yes!
Nice!
I assume that cannolis. I knew this. The food is massive. But you guys ready to talk about Back to Black? I think we are.
Sure.
Only if you give me a dollar.
I'll Venmo you later.
I'm back in black!
So this is back.
I'm back in black!
This is Back to Black, directed by Sam Taylor Johnson, who, by the way, is married to Aaron Taylor Johnson. I want to mention that Sam Taylor Johnson and Aaron Taylor Johnson got together when he was 18 and she was 42, so... What about that? This stars.
I want to quick tell your audience.
Wait, these guys
did not pick this movie. I made them pick it because I saw it was on Peacock and I wanted to watch it. So this is my fault.
Everything that you hear that comes out of my mouth in the next 10, 20 minutes is all his fault.
Yeah.
This stars Marissa.
Blame Canada.
This stars Marissa Abella as Amy Winehouse.
So the album's about going back to a black.
Also, Eddie Marsden plays Mitch.
Didn't agree with me.
Jack O'Connell plays Blake.
That's how much we're fucking poof in a thin air, you dumb shit.
Leslie Manville plays Cynthia.
Your son's dead.
This also stars Julie Cowan as Janice, Sam Buchanan as Nick Schmansky, Pete Lee Wilson plays Perfume Paul, and Michael S. Sigel plays Uncle Harold. Neil wants to do the storyline for Back to Black.
Oh, there's a storyline? I didn't even look.
Yeah.
Could you be any more passive aggressive about this one movie?
I'm just saying.
Look at this. Feels like ow. Shit.
Okay.
You know how hard it is for me to be like, oh, she's part of the 27 club. Yay.
I knew.
Anyway.
Okay. Well, you'll have your therapy moment in a moment.
A celebration of the most iconic and much missed homegrown star, the 21st. Oh, son of a bitch. I ain't reading that.
Go for it.
All right. The life and music of Amy Winehouse. I'm reading this one and I'm not reading that one because I don't believe
it. Oh, my God. Read something.
All right. Yes, I am. The life and music of Amy Winehouse, so the journey of adolescence to adulthood, and the creation of the best-selling album of our time.
Okay, let's start with two reviews. One was from my genius future leader of the world, 10-year-old son, Jonas Rattledge, whose remark at the end of this movie was two things. One, what the fuck? This looked like it took place in the span of a week. Two, normally when they make a movie like this, don't they usually start with, you know, as a child and then you see their entire career? And I had to explain to him, Back to Black is specifically about making the album Back to Black. Mm-hmm. She was already an established artist. She kind of had lost her way. She's in it with her management and the record company and all of that. And this is the movie about the story of how Back to Black specifically came to be, which he got once I explained that to him. And it would be kind of like if there was ever a movie about Metallica's The Black Album, you would start it after Injustice for All. You wouldn't start it with, you know, going back to San Francisco when the band formed. So the other thing I had, the other review that came to mind as I was watching this was critically acclaimed. It was Whitney Seibold and William Bibbiani, the Bibbs. And they were talking about how mean this movie is. And I'm dying to hear Neil's reaction to this. They were talking about how mean this movie is to Amy Winehouse, that the movie treats Amy Winehouse as if she's this dysfunctional, off-kilter, unsympathetic drug addict, and everybody else was a victim of her awfulness. Mm-hmm. As opposed to somebody who was clearly in need of help, kind of like a Mike Tyson situation where you've surrounded yourself with the most awful people, and no wonder you went off a fucking cliff in a barrel. And I'll tell you, I don't know how much I agree with that. I mean, obviously, Amy Winehouse was, you know, Michael Moshe.
Do you have a button that goes ding, 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 ding?
Neil's like, let me talk. At least as the movie presented the story, that's all I can speak to. Look, I'm so bad. I used to get Amy Winehouse and Lady Gaga mixed up. I didn't know which one was which. And the only song I knew of Amy Winehouse's was Rehab. But if you would ask me back in the day, who sings Rehab? Amy Winehouse, Lady Gaga, or Bette Midler? I didn't guess Bette Midler. Honestly, I had no fucking clue. And I knew who Bette Midler was. So I can only take the movie as it's presented. And I think the movie does present her somewhat sympathetically. Look, I'm sympathetic towards any artist who tries to maintain their artistic freedom and does not want to give in to the system, like the protected image, mm-hmm. the protected projected right. image, you know, that kind of Beatles-y, you know, it's that thing you do kind of a thing, where like, you know, Britney Spears, that kind of a thing.
Right.
Like, we're going to talk about that with Trap, actually. But, you know, that like, here, we're going to present you a certain way so that people will fall in love with you and buy your records. And she's like, no, I just want to be me. My songs have to come from, and she says it in the movie, my songs have to come from my life. I have to live my life. Then come the songs, then comes the popularity. That's the only order this is supposed to go in. And everyone around her is like, that's not how you sell records.
I mean, it sounds pretty.
I get why there's tension there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Go ahead. I'm sorry, Chris. I just wanted to finish that statement.
Yeah. So this movie, like, they make her just seem like the most insufferable person for most of it.
I'm going to go 50. I think being fair, it's 50% she's an insufferable twat and 50% everybody around her is awful.
All right, you know, what are you clapping? What should
I
mean?
Yeah, I slow clap that. I slow clap that into a fast clap. Okay. That's how direct on point. I am the only person in the circle that's ever met it. And it was like 10 minutes. And
I thought you said your friend met her. You met her? You met anyone else? Huh? I think you said your friend met her.
It was... No, no.
Oh, boy, here we go.
We were in a circle. It was in Lollapalooza. Sure. I think it was 2006
okay.
or 5.
Okay, it was, after it was awful. It was, got it.
And I don't remember where, but she came up. I'm not going to go into the full detail of this story, but she came up. She was rude to my bandmate in front of me. And then, like, she kind of just walked. Like, she came in from the night. Like, it was just, like, appeared.
She appeared then, from like, Shadows of Batman.
So she came, yeah, like, Snoop Dogg like when Batman. Someone's out to join. Gotcha.
Who
are you? Yeah.
I'm Amy.
And she asked for stuff, and we didn't have the stuff she was asking for. You could take whatever you want from that. And then she just kind of faded off. And, like, but she was just rude about it. Like, every, like, her attitude was... But it was only for 5 minutes, guys. But Neil, so, Neil, I mean, by Neil, any means,
you have the same story about Soli Erna. You have the same story about Soli Erna.
No, Godsmack? That's a complete different fucking story. No, okay. That's a complete.
Without getting too much more into her as a person, a couple of things about the movie. Before we move on. This is an ugly movie. Mm-hmm. Everything is in a fucking shadow. They went for like natural lighting, and they came up with no lighting. Every scene.
I want to support your fact really quick just by one giving you one image. I think at the beginning of this movie, if they put this up front, I think we all could have agreed about this movie. And here it is. If they had that at the beginning of the movie, the after school special symbol, because that's the way this movie looked like it was filmed. It looked like it was filmed for an after school special.
Okay,
like,
have you ever seen the really make... Have you ever seen the Basketball Diaries?
Yes. Yes,
yeah.
Ma. You listen. Ma. You gotta give me some money. Ma. Yeah. Anyway. This movie is lit and shot and acted like it's the Basketball Diaries, but Cockney.
Yeah.
And instead of like, you know, Leonardo DiCaprio, it's, you know, it's a fucking chick singer.
So for they did definitely make this like a. Like a standard biopic, there's those shots of them, you know, her doing a whole song, looking super into it. And Cynthia Johnson, director, I don't think she's a great director. It's because, I mean, but she's known for 50 Shades of Grey, whatever the fuck that means, when it comes to this.
Well, that explains a lot.
Yeah, because this thing is really, it's kind of pedestrian. You know what I mean? Like, it just seems like, it seems, goes to the
there's
shots.
There's no aesthetic style.
Oh, what the hell?
Everything is poorly lit.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's like I said, I went for like the Basketball Diary because the Basketball Diary, they went out of their way to shoot like really grainy and gritty. Mm-hmm. You know, it was supposed to be kind of muddy and sludgy. That's what they were going for. This one, I think they were trying to go for the same thing, but it was like, but I don't know how purposeful that was. I feel like they were just like, well, London's rainy, so we have to just shoot rainy, you know, and people don't always have their lights on, so we'll just shoot that. And it's like, what? This is the ugliest fucking movie I've seen in quite some time. Like, I just listened to myself review The Idol because, again, I listened to critically acclaimed guys do Cancel Too Soon, and they talked about The Idol. And it reminded me about how you really do have to be mindful of your setting, mindful of where you shoot your movie. Like, if you watch The Idol, I learned they shot it at The Weeknd's actual house, and his house is the most beige thing you've ever fucking seen. It really does look like somebody who would run a cult, except that it's not portrayed as his house. It's mostly portrayed as Lily Rose Depp's house. Here it's kind of the same thing. It was just like they just shot around this, you know, area of England where the studio and the record company and she was. But there's a way of doing that it doesn't look god awful.
It looks ugly as
shit. This movie does. So you take that.
We're gonna have to talk about that in the next movie too, because of how they shot things there.
Yeah. My son's thing about like it moves way too quickly. Like basically what he was saying is there's a huge pacing issue with this movie. It's like I'm twatty. I meet a guy. I'm in love. They break up. I'm twatty again. And I'm sad. You know, and it's like, wait, she's like, I want to have six. I want to be a mom and have six babies. And my son looks at me. He's like, didn't they just meet?
Yeah, also, the thing with that is they protest on that just a little bit. People are telling me, yeah, she wanted a baby, but they're like, two sentences about it, and I'm like, okay. But she, I don't want to say Marissa Abella was bad, and apparently she's her own singing, whatever that is. But it was, it was, I mean, it was bad. If it wasn't, it was.
She's a fine actress. She's portraying the character as well as.
She was in a lot of good stuff too, Chris. By the
way, I'm not saying anything bad about it. I thought she was pretty good. And Eddie Marston was good. I thought all the acting was good, but like the pacing, the whole movie itself, kind of shitty. So
last thing I'm going to say, and then I'm going to shut up and let you guys finish. Mm-hmm. If you make a movie, think about Bohemian Rhapsody mm-hmm. or Rocket Man, mm-hmm. which. I'm not saying you have to like or dislike either one of those movies, but you at least get a sense of how important Queen was in Bohemian Rhapsody. You get a sense of how important Wonder. Also, Rocket Man's awesome.
Oh, it's way better than that. It's a head and shoulders above Bohemian Rhapsody. But way better.
You get a sense of what made Elton John important to Western culture because mm-hmm. he is right. World renowned. If you make a movie about the importance of a particular album. Like, again, if you were going to do AC/DC's Back in Black, your main objective has to convince the audience why this album is an important cornerstone of Western culture or mm-hmm. fuck off.
Uh-huh. Or not just Western culture, but to mm-hmm. them. Because it also seemed like it wasn't even fucking important to her that she even released the goddamn album.
Right, and that's where
we know nothing about how it was made. Nothing about it at all.
Yeah. I don't get it. Well, I mean, she's sad and twatty and on drugs. That's pretty much how Back to Black came across. Yeah, yeah. Like, you know, it's a reflection of how sad and twatty and on drugs I am.
It's basically a reflection of like every karaoke singer girl that I've ever met. I want to be a singer.
That'd be great. Rename the album Karaoke drugs. Songs. I don't get a sense of why this album is important, other than I happen to know that the album did very well. Who gives a fuck? Why does this resonate with people? I don't get that sense from the movie.
I don't know if it didn't translate because it's. I don't know who the audience is for. It's, I guess, for people like Daniel Finehouse or for the UK audiences. They talked about all the paparazzi and shit. The reason she had paparazzi because she was a fucking mess. That was interesting to the European press over there. But like you said, like.
Well, they killed Princess Diana. I don't think they really care about celebrities in England.
Yeah, they don't. But I mean, they played up the paparazzi as part of the point of like why she's so inside the home drinking all the time. But it's like, really? That's like the only thing I got from the movie. Like, yeah. I didn't
that she was a victim of the press. That's why she did what she did, which...
I'm sorry. You don't get to throw the I'm a victim of the press thing out there while Diana crashing into a fucking wall running from the paparazzi is still out there. And in case you forgot, The Crown just did it about a year or two ago.
So, I mean, to get my piece in about this movie really quick, like, because I've only added here and there from you guys talking. Sorry. I agree with you guys about the pacing part. I agree with you about the fact that nothing made any sense. I agree with you said your son said that, where it was like she's 12 and then she's 35, like, you know, in the same week. You know, like, I agree with that. That, like, for some reason.
Same actress.
It's like, and she didn't look any older. And her tattoos weren't even barely on her. And I think she had the tattoos since she was, like, 15, I think. I don't know. Like, everything just didn't make sense. Nothing felt in... They made things not feel important in this film. Nothing in his... made me go, okay, that's why the album was created. Okay, that's why she's a singer. Oh, that's why, you know, there was not enough of the story, the backstory or anything for me to go, hey, that's important. I should probably listen to this part of the movie so I know what else is going on throughout the film. And I don't think there's one part of this movie where I was like, oh, was that important? Like,
if you want an example of how to do this
short or not,
if you want an example of how to do this right, it's the whole length and breadth of her career. But I think I Want to Dance with Somebody, the Whitney Houston biopic from a few years ago. Jason Teasley and I reviewed it for Black History Month earlier this year, and we did it as a triple feature. We did that one. We did What's Love Got to Do with It, which is the Tina Turner, Ike Turner story, and then we did Respect, which is about Aretha Franklin.
And you saw that.
And I will tell you, I Want to Dance with Somebody, I think, does a magnificent job of explaining in vascular detail why Whitney Houston is important to the culture and what made her special.
We did not watch I Want to Dance with Everybody because you said no. Anyway, continue.
because Chris hates black people. What?
Well, come on.
Chris hates music biopics. Chris hates music biopics.
I'm sorry, Chris. Because you have to understand, I do that to Ronnie Adams all the time. Okay, it's driving crazy.
So I hate Bohemian Rhapsody, but I love Rocket Man. And
okay.
He hates music. He hates music that has anything to do with music on film.
I'm gonna take up Chris's side though. Like I mean, I like them, but I'm a huge music fan. But I understand why a lot of people don't like biopics. One, I mean, these were done. So many of these are done so much the same way that they had to do Walk Hard as a parody of it.
I'd much rather a documentary about musicians than a biopic. Like for example, like I don't know if you guys saw Amy. That's a great documentary.
I used to love the VH1's Behind the Music for that reason.
Oh, those are great too.
And for example,
my favorite music, I have two favorite music documentaries, which is I'm trying to Break Your Heart, because documentary about making You Can Tell Foxtrot, and Instrument, the film by Fugazi. My two favorite, probably the documentaries, and they're both music documentaries. And so when it's seasonally like Back to Black or when you're actually. Even Rocketman, you know, I love Rocketman. I know we're getting some sort of spin on the story that's nowhere close to real life, you know?
Yeah, it's funny. One of my cousins is a huge Elton John fan. Like he's like an Elton John historian. And he was like, I don't know who they're talking about because that's not him.
Yeah.
you know, like, he was like, there's a lot of stuff that wasn't right about that movie. And I heard like the Bohemian Rhapsody also. It's so funny. I think the worst offender of this I heard was like, I think it was the Def Leppard VH1 movie from years ago. Like I was a kid at the time.
I remember,
oh my god, the VH1 Def Leppard movie basically was like,
what was it called?
I don't remember. But they cleaned themselves up and then did the Hysteria tour. And my friend laughed hard at that. He was like, oh my god, they drank so much on the Hysteria tour.
Hysteria.
Yeah.
2001 is called Hysteria, the Def Leppard story.
Neil, gotcha. Neil, do you remember how much we loved Rocket Man?
I absolutely love it. I still I fall asleep to it constantly. It's like one of my favorite like musical movies that has come out in the last, I mean, I think since like Sweeney Todd, I think it was, or you know, like,
Mark,
like seriously, Mark, it's like,
Mark, do you like
because Hamilton sucked, and The Heights sucked, like, you know, all those other musicals.
Didn't suck. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. Anything Manuel Lewis sucks. If you want me to, I can talk like him the whole podcast. I can sit here and
please
make
don't,
it always
please
last.
Don't, please
I
don't.
Can always in see the, everything
in
the way
in the room where it happened. The room where it happened. I was in the room where it happened. The room where it happened.
God. Mark, every musical he writes sounds exactly the same.
Mark, I'm not debating that point with you. I just don't think In the Heights sucks. Yes, Chris.
Do you like Bohemian Rhapsody or Rocket Man more? Which one?
Rocket Man's a better movie.
There we go.
Okay. Yeah.
That's
but plus, I'm a bigger hang on. I'm a bigger Queen fan than I am an Elton John fan. Yeah, but me too. I am so objective in the way I look at things. Like you really have to drill down and kind of like waterboard me to get my actual opinion about things because my therapist described me as Batman because of my sense of like fairness and justice. So everything I'm just constantly like looking at things, you know, it's like well, which one did you like more? Well, no, Rocket Man's a better movie than Bohemian Rhapsody. Which did you like more? Oh, fucking Bohemian Rhapsody. I'm sorry. God,
but the thing is, the thing I didn't like about Bohemian Rhapsody was, Freddie's dead. Let's just blame all the shit on him.
And it also is like, they're making it seem like he was gay, like it was a bad thing. I was like, what the fuck's going on here? They made it seem like.
Well, I mean, back then it was a band killer. Back in the in that age, but two, they always blamed him. They blamed him in the movie for the drug fueled parties, which it wasn't Freddie. It was all of them. They literally had a house just for drug fueled parties. If you're asking me,
but like, why do you like Bohemian? Because like, again, because they don't want us, and it's an anathema to me to sound like a dummy, unless I'm making a joke. But it's one of those dummy comments, and I'm gonna just blurt it out and judge me. I like Queen. I really like Queen.
Queen's
it's one of my favorite bands.
You're a good band.
And so watching a 2-hour movie where I get to hear Queen's music makes me happy.
Yeah.
But Rocketman's a better movie. I'm sorry.
Okay. But anyway, guys, at this point, we need to do some because we're like almost an hour in. And we haven't done news. We haven't done the second movie. Right. The ratings, guys.
My rating on this is like a 2.9. Like I watched it. I didn't hate myself after watching it, but I'm sure Neil's gonna give it a CD thing. It's not a very good movie, but it's there and it was just there. And I didn't hate myself watching it. So 2.9 is my score on this. Mark, what's your gonna be your bullshit score?
Damn it! I give it a bronze medal at the Olympics.
There we go.
What Olympics? Whoa. What Olympics?
The Paris Olympics, you know, with all the trans people.
Oh, the Paris Olympics. Okay, so not like the 1970s Olympics. You're talking
about the current one with the trans people in the women's Olympic boxing category, where they're all biological women.
I don't want to cut this out.
I'm not saying anything wrong. She's a biological woman.
Yeah, she is. She's a woman.
She is. Yeah. Fucking haters.
Good. Thank you. Because I was going nuts on this.
I am an ally of the intersex community, okay? Leave that woman alone.
Okay, good. I'm with you. Thank God.
Chris just shit his face. Chris just passed a fucking kidney stone.
I don't know if you guys saw my Facebook said that. I had to unfriend some transphobic folk. And I did, by the way, but
God damn, I'm sorry that you know those
I
people.
Fucked up. Oh. I honestly had to read into it before I realized what was happening, because I initially thought it was a trans issue, and then it's like, nope, she's not trans. She's biological woman. Yeah, she's intersex. It's a whole other
it's
thing.
Just idiots. It's just
idiots. Yeah,
I did.
Anyway,
all right.
It was someone I didn't know personally. By the way, when someone didn't know personally, it was the fiance of a friend. And now I judge that friend. But Neil, I'm sorry.
Chris, please get back on track before Neil has an aneurysm.
Please come back. Neil, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Please
come
back. I love you.
We're
at an
hour, guys.
I like this. Like, yeah. Is it a problem that like hanging out with all of us? Is it a problem, Neil?
But we got way more shit to talk about.
Okay. Neil has blow to do in the bathroom with his wrestling friends. Keep it going.
All right, Neil. What's your score on this?
All right. You know, I work for a major media company, right? You know that, right?
Does that mean you're censoring comments? What does that mean?
No, I made a joke, and Neil's like, shut up.
Okay. All right.
Dumbass. Can't take that. Anyway. What was I going to say? I don't even know what we're talking
score,
about anymore.
Your score for this movie.
I get to give a score now. Finally. Let's see. On this movie, 1.8?
Okay.
Wow. Okay. I'll give it a 2.3. I'll go that high. But I don't think, and this has nothing to do with what the subject matter is, but it has more to do with the consistency. This film made no sense. Nothing followed each other. The whole age thing, where I had no idea what age she was at any time, was an actual thing on my side as well, where I'm just like, okay, so now we're 3 years. Where are we?
I want to rewatch the movie, but have you and my son do a commentary track.
Oh my God, I would love it. Let's do it. Tomorrow. Oh, wait a minute. No, I can't. I'll be at SmackDown. But
oh my God.
And then I'm at Hoser on Monday or Saturday. I gotta be front row for Hoser.
Neil already yelled at me once for making a drug joke, so I have to hold that one back. But sorry.
Yeah, but anyway, this is Disney Deadpool, man.
Damn it.
But anyway, Chris, what's the ratings on Rotten Tomatoes?
Okay, so what do you think the audience score on Back to Black is?
48.
86%.
Oh my God.
I know, I'm gonna shoot myself. Okay, what is the critic score on?
I'm getting my gun.
Put your gun away.
I can't make coke jokes, but you can make suicide jokes. Wow!
I know.
I want to please send me your HR fucking manual.
All right, Neil. I will. What is the critic score for Back to Black?
Oh man, 71.
35%.
Damn it! Yeah,
I'm not surprised.
Okay, what critics consensus is: Back to Black sympathetic approach to its subject story is an overdue antidote to the tabloid treatment. She often receives in life, even if the end results are disappointingly pedestrian. The words I used, a pedestrian. I'm gonna read I'm gonna use a really good review and a bad review. This is from Jack Martin of Filmfeeder. He says, "Their film is like the media perception in yourself, often the messing that you hear, but it does take the bare minimum, humanizing the member of the 27 Club more easily than it could have." And here is Callan Cooper of Movies We Texted About. He says, "It's not just a disservice to Winehouse and her legacy; it's a disservice to compelling storytelling." Whatever, this movie exists. Neil gave it a CD tag of 2.3. He's still there. And then,
is he still?
I don't
Mark? Know. Mark? Are you naked?
I think he had to step away for a second.
Ah, all right. That was weird. Anyway, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, go.
So, yeah, you guys can watch this on Peacock. And, if you want to wish time, Neil hated it. Mark gave it a bronze medal. And I'm okay with it.
Hey, man, I'm just saying this. We can all do better in life. And that's all that matters.
All right. You ready for news? Mark, you ready for news?
Yeah. Mark, are you okay? Did he die?
I had to pee.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Mark had to pee.
I was trying to be subtle and quiet. Fuck Chris me for trying.
Like, I know. Chris is like, "Where'd Mark go?
I didn't do that. Neil's eyes were like, "What the fuck? Like, where is she?" And I'm like, he had to step away for a second. But yeah, you ready for news, Neil?
My God, next time I'll just bring the camera in with you guys to watch.
Yeah.
Woo! You kicked off YouTube.
This is the Movies Don't Suck and some of them news. I'm going to read stuff. Mark's probably already heard it, but Chris lives in a dumpster behind a Dollar General, so he doesn't read much news.
I do news, but not this. Not movie news, because Neil gives it to me every week. So.
Hey, remember all those Army of Dead sequels and animated series that we were going to get?
Yeah, we were super excited about that. Not really.
Please say they're canceled. Please say they're canceled. Please say they're canceled.
They're all been canceled.
So Netflix
so
lost.
So nobody knows about it.
Netflix lost their goodwill towards Zack Snyder after the abortions that were Rebel Moon wanted part one and part two. So
you mean the porno? Do you mean the sci-fi porno?
Oh wait, I forgot they did. They add nudity to the director's cut.
Dude, there's like a fuck scene. There ain't even nudity. There is just a fuck scene.
Is there PIV? Is there PIV?
Like, it was like they're butt naked going at it like it's a hardcore Sharon Stone movie from the 90s.
Well,
like, it was like, well, that's I was just like,
that's not gonna be so, that's not
what
gonna,
the hell?
That's not gonna entice me to watch it though. So, like,
oh no, yeah, I would just want to. No, 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 wait. Before you even say that, yeah. I didn't add it to the news or anything because I didn't want to talk about it. But okay, I'll tell you, they literally, the director's cut has over 22% above. On Rotten Tomatoes and stuff. And I'm guessing 100% it has to do with the gore
send me an edit of them fucking in Rebel Moon because that's about all I want.
So wait,
watch
wait, that so wait, now, so now it's a 33% instead of the 12%. Is that we're getting hit with because of the score?
No, it's like almost a 70% because of it. Dude.
Oh, Army of the Dead was a great movie. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. I mean, like, don't get me wrong. It's like it's not fucking Schindler's List or anything, but for what it was, you know, it was again. There's only so much you can do with the zombie genre. I liked Army of the Dead, and I never wanted to see anything else from that universe. And I hated the fact that we have one halfway decent streaming movie, and it's like cinematic universe. It's like, oh, go fuck yourself.
Army of Thieves came out, right? Like
which we reviewed also. And I'm like, independently of Army of the Dead as just a heist movie, it's fine. It's fine for streamable, you know, consumable material. But, you know, that's exactly what it is. It fit in the giant morass, this giant pile of forgettable, streamable movies.
Okay. All right, Neil.
Shang-Chi 2 is still happening. Awkwafina just said in an interview when she was interviewing for the movie that we'll be reviewing next week or 2 weeks from today, you know, of course, you know, with John Cena, because we watch everything
Jackpot.
John Cena
here.
The zero on Rotten Tomatoes movie? Perfect.
Oh, wait, is it really?
Nice!
How much we're fucking...
Sorry. I was doing for a mouse.
What are you doing today, Chris?
You're killing me. Cat on your lap that keeps pressing keys.
Yeah, dude. Right.
Maybe I need to be open.
Is your belly like hanging over the like my belly? Sometimes.
Fuck you, dude. Fuck
you, man. My belly hangs over the. Well, I'm just saying, mine does.
No, mine's like much higher than my belly is. So.
But anyway, Shang-Chi 2 might be one of the hidden ones that they did not announce this last week or the last 2 weeks at the San Diego Comic-Con. That is one of the ones that we haven't figured out what's part of the next phase of Marvel. So
because Marvel doesn't know anymore.
We're still getting it.
Yeah, they're still figuring it out. Boop, boop.
But you know what movies we are getting? We are getting not one, not two, but we are getting three Star Wars movies in 2026 and 2027. One being, of course, Mandalorian. The other one being Grogu. And the other one is going to be Sean Levy, the guy who just did Deadpool and Wolverine, the highest grossing R-rated movie of all time, beating anybody that's ever existed in R-rated movies. Because now they're number one domestically.
I get you.
He will be doing a Star Wars movie that has nothing to do with anything Skywalker saga. It'll be a whole different time frame, a whole different era. And we know we all love it because Star Wars is the second greatest franchise next to Star Trek.
Mark's trying to hang himself.
Mark is hanging himself a lot over there. I don't know why.
Two bullets and I hung myself. That's how much I hate Star Wars now.
Did you used to love Star Wars? Or did you always not like it?
I'm born in 1976. I grew up with Star Wars. My first birthday, I had a Chewbacca and an R2-D2 cake. Not that I picked them, I was one. But, you know, I watched those movies when they came
out.
I was fucking four. When Empire Strikes Back came out, and then I was seven, I think. What a Wookiee! When Return of the Jedi came out, I watched Droids. I watched Ewok. I watched the Ewok specials. You know, I read the books. I loved the Thrawn trilogy, The Courtship of Princess Leia, Shadows of the Empire. I played.
Oh, Heir to the Emperor! Oh, right there. Bam.
So, like, the reason why I'm kind of annoyed now is I have a friend who, like, oh, you're not a real Star Wars fan. I'm sorry. At some point, I have the right to say, fuck this franchise. When I was a fan, loved it. And when Disney bought Star Wars and we were getting new Star Wars movies, I was excited. I was like, oh, good. This thing that I loved from my childhood is back. And then they did The Force Awakens. And I was like, okay, good start. And then they fucked the dog. Whether or not you love or hate The Last Jedi, it was handled poorly. The difference between the stuff they were doing at Marvel was you had Kevin Feige treating it like a television show. You could. Edgar Wright walked off Ant-Man because they wouldn't let him just do fuck all with Ant-Man. And they brought in whatever, you know, hack they had do it because he was going to follow orders. Everybody that, you know, everybody that comes on board, whether you're what's her nuts from the Eternals, Chloe Zhao, you know, or you're a hack or you're the Russo brothers or whatever. When you go to Marvel, you are signing up to join the military. You will follow orders and do as told. And their story was cohesive. And what do you know? Lobster Endgame makes $2 billion. Then they go to do this with fucking Star Wars. And they're just like, okay, J.J. Abrams does his, you know, fucking magic box thing, his mystery box thing. Let's bring in a new director and not give him any instructions, not tell him what to do. He's like, I'm just going to do whatever the fuck I want with this. Which is fine. I like The Last Jedi. I know. I'm part of that group. I actually enjoy The Last Jedi. I like The Last Jedi
too.
But people would say we're not Star Wars fans because of that.
I liked it too. That scene with Luke Skywalker at the end.
Just all of it. Like I liked that it went against screen, except that it was over then. There was nothing. There was no more story at the end of The Last Jedi. And it's like, and then Rise of Skywalker was an abortion.
Yeah, it sucked.
Speaking of which,
it sucked.
So my point is, it's like, and then they do two seasons of The Mandalorian, which were great, and it ended perfectly, and it gave us that Luke Skywalker send-off we all wanted, and they fucking ruined it with Book of Boba Fett. And that last season of The Mandalorian was the Bo-Katan show. They have, from what I understand... Yeah. The Clone Wars was a great cartoon. Adults and children loved it equally. And they gave us Ahsoka. Like, look, all your favorite characters are back. Couldn't have been a more boring, bland story. So my point being, so I can shut up and let you guys have your show back, since you triggered me, is like I was a loyal Star Wars fan. You've been warned. you, and except that you fucked me every step of the way since this franchise was turned over to Disney. Obi-Wan Kenobi was a meh show at best, and then they started throwing mountains at each other, and I went, that's it. Lex Lugering my pants off. I'm walking away from this whole stupid fucking franchise. And hate me if you want, call me not a Star Wars fan. Bad writing is bad writing. Meh shows are meh shows. And I'm not going to say that they're better than they really are when they're not. This company fucks the dog on a regular basis. And oh, I'm sorry, have you watched The Acolyte? It's yeah. It's like it was adapted for 13-year-old lesbians from a YA novel. And I'm sorry, for those of you who love adapted YA novels, enjoy yourselves, but that's not what I'm into.
I'm with you.
I'm going to go watch The Wire now. Goodbye.
Moving on to a franchise that we all moving on to a franchise that we all can agree that is awesome. The same people that have brought us Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey, Winnie the Pooh, Part 2, and Steamboat's Willie has released Bambi: The Reckoning, where it is a deer that follows a mother and son that are being haunted by a vengeful deer after a car accident.
So I hear that these things are getting progressively a little better, and I hope that someday they have a good movie.
How have we not gotten Bambi versus Godzilla in this franchise?
I know, right? Like, when are we going to get Mega Shark versus the whale?
Sharknado versus Bambi.
Also talking about horror movies that are getting sequels or moving on in their franchises. Starting at the beginning of October, Five Nights at Freddy's Part 2 will start filming.
I can't stand that movie. I've seen it
with
twice.
With Matthew Lillard being like excited.
My kids acted like it was fucking Avengers Endgame. I ain't got shit to say about it. Make more of these. Make my children happy.
I can't stand it. I saw it twice.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, so this is the most important job he has that he falls asleep in. I was like,
let me tell you, there's nothing like being in a theater full of kids who are hooting and hollering, and you're the old man who has no idea what's happening. Yeah. Why they're, you know, and I always come back, he said the thing, and I'm just like, what now? What's happening? Where are my pants?
All right, Neil, move on.
Sad news. Famous director David Lynch will not ever be able to direct in person.
Yeah,
ever again. He's going to be directing from his own home because he got emphysema, and from the smoking he's done for decades, and so therefore he is going to start directing remotely, which is, I guess you can do that today. I mean, they did that during the pandemic, right?
He hasn't made a movie in 20 years. I don't know, but I mean, I like David Lynch as a cultural figure, and I like some of his movies. But his movies.
Here's my question.
Yeah,
is there an audience left that still intelligent enough to appreciate a David Lynch movie?
I don't know. I mean, I love Blue Velvet. I love. What's the movie with Wild at Heart? I love Wild at Heart. That's incredible.
Say Dark Highway. I think that's another David Lynch one.
Yeah. And so, like, those are Lost Highway. They're all great, but you can't find them anymore streaming. That's the craziest thing. That's why there's no audience, because the only way you find Wild at Heart is if you order a DVD. So, like, and who does that anymore? So, poor David Lynch.
All right. So, we got a movie coming from J.J. Abrams, which will be with Jenna Ortega and Glenn Powell, because Glenn Powell's in fucking everything now. But the two of them, we're not going to get any information about that until the movie is almost done. It is being hidden. But here's a movie that's going to get you ready for this, Mark. Chris is going to get a hard on. Watch. You ready? A24 is making a movie with Ari Aster.
Mm-hmm. Give me more.
With Zendaya. And Robert Pattinson.
Okay, I'm gonna watch it regardless.
Those are all people you jerked off to.
Ari Aster for sure. Zendaya not so much. Robert Pattinson maybe. He's a pretty good actor.
Zendaya is built more like a man than the turpish.
I'm with you, man. She's you guys don't know this, but I'm a member of the Triple A24. Fan club right here. So, oh, nice.
Is that a real thing?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, my wife got me a subscription for a year, and today I won $24 of A24 gift shop stuff from their zine that had a stretch off, and I won $24 for the A24 shop.
Yeah, he's going to get a sex toy. But anyway,
maybe. I don't know.
The last story of the day that we're going to talk about. Are you ready? Mm-hmm. This makes me happy. So, there's a pro wrestler that I am not the hugest fan of ever. I'm a fan of all his villains, you know, like Andre the Giant, Roddy Piper, you know, all his villains. It's
about Hulkster?
Hulk Hogan, and even Macho Man, if you notice Macho Man right there. Hulk Hogan is getting the biography movie finally.
Cool, man.
Is this the one that the Netflix one where Chris Hemsworth is playing him?
No, that one got canned and it's gone.
Okay, what happened to the Vince McMahon one that was going to be on Netflix?
Yeah, this one is going to be written by Matt Damon and Ben Affleck. And the name of the movie is called Killing Walker.
What?
Killing who?
It's about the video where they have him recorded talking about how he hates black people.
Oh, that's awesome. That's fucking awesome.
How he sued them and completely killed that website.
Gawker. Killing Gawker.
Gawker, I'm sorry.
But dude, I fucking love the idea of this, though. Gawker. Are they actually going to show the flaws of this man?
And it is going to be directed by Good Will Hunting's Gus Van Sant.
Oh, I want to see this bad. Yeah. I want to see this badly.
I can't lie. I will absolutely see that movie, but I hate myself for it.
I love every moment of this. I'm glad that POS gets thrown in the mud where he belongs.
Look, I'm not a Hulk Hogan fan, but I feel like... Okay. I'm already in enough trouble with Neil for saying controversial shit on this podcast.
Let's do it about Hulkster.
No, I want to talk about Bill Cosby. Bill Cosby is a rapist and should have gone to prison, and he should have stayed in prison. I'm not debating that. I'm not here to say, oh, but, you know, but did he really? Yes, he fucking raped those women. So debate about that. I don't feel like we should throw Bill Cosby's entire fucking career out the window. That man lended himself to the fabric of American culture, Western culture at large. People loved Bill Cosby far and wide. His stuff, he is on the Mount Rushmore of comedians. And I feel like every time we whitewash history because somebody fucked up real bad, you know, or it's a terrible human being.
Right.
So we're going to ignore their entire life and breadth of what they've done. So back to Hulk Hogan, you're going to reduce Hulk Hogan's entire career and what, you know, and what he contributed to the culture down to a private conversation that shouldn't have been public in the first place. That's fucked up.
I mean,
I've chastised everybody.
No. But we all know how huge of a pro wrestling fan. In fact, I have a 1986 lunchbox right there. Has the Hulkster right there. I have the complete collection of AEW cards. And of course, it has Hulkster on the... Oops, I showed the empty page.
The whole thing. Yeah.
But yeah. So, you know, Hulkster's always going to be a part of pro wrestling, period. Nothing we can do. Mm-hmm. We can't erase that. And the thing is, I also agree with you on the Bill Cosby thing, because this is a thing that nobody ever talks about. Do you know the microphones that Martin Luther King talked into of the I Have a Dream speech were all paid for by Bill Cosby? Mm-hmm. Like, the reason black comedians got like a start on television because of Bill Cosby. Yeah. The first black cartoon that ever did not make fun or mock the black culture was a Bill Cosby cartoon.
There are things that he did
that are very positive in the world. But it's like Elvis Presley. Elvis Presley was a pedophile, but nobody ever fucking talks about that. As was
Jerry Lee Lewis.
Yeah.
You know, just sticking with just black comedians or whatever, you're going to sit there and tell me Red Fox didn't have a fucked up moment in his life that if it was made public would have ruined him? Get the fuck out of here. That's Red Fox.
This is a bunch of people.
You're going to sit there and tell me that one of my one of the most brilliant actors, one of the brilliant comedians, you know, a paragon of American culture, Richard Pryor, didn't have a fucked up moment that wasn't publicized, aside from him setting himself on fire while doing
drugs. Dude, he burnt himself on crack.
Richard Pryor is probably my favorite comedian. He's probably my favorite comedian of all time.
But that's my point. Like, we sit there and like,
yeah, and he burned down Bill Cosby. His housewife freebasing crack.
Sit there and we point a finger at Bill Cosby. He went to Bill Cosby. It was horrendous, and he was rightly punished for it. Okay, so but he also has his other stuff. As do all these other people,
including Dave Bowie.
So I get irritated with the Hulk Hogan thing because, like, a Hulk Hogan brought joy to so many people and made pro wrestling what it is today. You know, this thing that Neil can't get over. but again, he has a private moment. Like, he didn't look. People are acting as if Hulk Hogan went, you know, got on stage at the Grammys and was like, "Fuck black people." That's not what happened. He had a private. You're gonna sit there and tell me in your lives, in all of your life, you've never said a weird thing that if it got out would make you look bad. Get the fuck out of here.
Oh god,
But it happened to 6'7" blonde-haired white Hulk Hogan, so now he's the devil. That stuff irritates me.
Okay,
you know. There's only one thing I can say about this, and then I'll wrap this up so we can go to the last movie. I know that growing up watching pro wrestling and stuff like that, there are people that have messed up a lot. But there is one person that is blonde-haired, has a beard, and is actually 10 times better than Hulk Hogan. We all know who he is. If we say his name, I think he'll appear.
God damn it.
Yeah, that's right. Joe Hinchcliffe. Yeah! That's the news! That was the Movies Don't Suck and Some of Them News. We said a bunch of stuff that might be controversial, so please don't let your grandma listen.
I don't know if I have to cut that much out, but because this is a show on YouTube forever. This is a show on YouTube forever, and the only thing I can get rid of is that I can go in the video and edit it, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to wait until, I don't know, 5 years from now when we're on, when we see the crawl on CNN, it'll say, Neil Blackwood, Chris Owen, Mark Radulich of the Movies Don't Suck podcast said this 5 years ago.
I'm never going to be that. When I move to Philly in a year or two, it doesn't really matter. When I move there, nobody's going to give a shit. I'll be working like at a counter at a Starbucks or something.
Far worse things on my own podcast.
Yeah, I know. Right? Let's get to it, guys.
All right. Let's talk Trap. Directed by In My Shame with Ding Dong. He did, you guys don't know, Sixth Sense and the masterpiece After Earth and The Happening. but you guys know you didn't.
And don't forget The Last Airbender.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Unbreakable, Split, Glass, Old, Knock at the Cabin Door. And he's back with his newest one, Trap. This stars Josh Hartnett as was his name, Cooper. Shit, fuck, hold on. There we go.
You know, a friend of mine asked me before I got here.
Ariel Donahue and Shalika Shimon Ding Dong as Riley and Lady Raven, respectively.
How are y'all doing, my queens and kings?
Dad, this is literally the best day of my life.
Also, Allison Pill as Rachel.
Whoops. You know that signal you use to puppet around your Borg?
Haley Mills as Dr. Josephine Grant.
Hey, you want to come to the comment share and get a popsicle with me?
Also, Jonathan Langdon as Jamie, the comedic support or the real comic relief.
I pretend I'm foreign to get girls.
Neil, watch out. I'm going to mention that Kid Cudi's in this as the thinker. What the fuck? And of course, In My Shyamalan shows up as Spotter in this. Well, we didn't expect anything less. You know, why don't you go ahead and read the storyline for Trap?
In M. Night Shyamalan's latest outing, everyone in a large city is in a frenzy. Why? That's because they're up and ready to watch a concert performed by famous pop star Lady Raven. Two of her fans, a man named Cooper and her daughter Riley attended the concert with high spirits, but things slowly begin to change. Their tune, amongst the screams of adoration and sounds of applause, the concert itself has a hidden identity, a front to fish out an infamous serial killer known as The Butcher. With security cameras rigged, armies of policemen with weapons at the ready, and police vehicles surrounding the venue, will anyone survive their concert experience, or is there more to The Butcher than meets the eye?
So I want to mention this real quick about before I forget. This reminded me a lot of the third Lord of the Rings movie, as it ended five times before it actually did.
Hey, did you guys know that M. Night Shyamalan has a daughter named Shyamalan, and she sings for a living? Did you know
no,
that?
No, I do
her
now.
Her hair is so pretty.
I know.
Okay.
She's so pretty.
Oh, man. Man. All right, you know what? You guys started in the last one. I'll get this one. I'll just get it out of the way. Let's just do it. Let's get it done and over with. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Josh Harnett saved the movie. He's the only reason this movie was any good. But this whole movie was a music video for M. Night Shyamalan's daughter. There were so many times she sang complete songs in the movie for no reason at all.
I thought that was weird for sure.
It's a fucking Luke Cage argument. Oh no, not another concert.
It was just like, anyway,
there was a lot of this movie where they're singing that I didn't care about at all.
No, none whatsoever. It didn't even push the story along in some parts. It was just there. I kind of felt like I was at a concert, if that's what he was trying to get me to feel like. I felt like I was watching a live music video, like on MTV when they used to do the live programs and they'd follow the fans around and be like, oh my God, I'm in sync. You know, like those old videos that they did.
How's it go again?
You know how it went. You heard it. Anyway. My thing is the fact that God bless Josh Harnett, because he made the movie like I could watch it. Like, he gave me a reason to watch the movie. And him and actor Jonathan, which I'm sure Mark will jump in here in a second and say his piece on that. But, like, those two guys in the movie made it kind of like, at least, all right, I had a good time.
You mean
those
4 minutes, maybe, of screen time they both had together?
I know. But even separate, when they did whatever they did. But still, it was just like, okay, that kind of made, but if they just cut the music performances down a little bit and, like, made it like the normal. I know, right?
But I have a question. It doesn't look like Josh Harnett was wearing a hairpiece the whole time. Did anyone else get that feeling, too? Like, it wasn't his real hair? Or is that just me?
Yeah, he didn't look like him. I had to check the cast. So I was starting to say before, I don't talk about my daughter much on here. I was like, because my son's the one with the concerted opinions about movies. My daughter's like, I like everything.
Oh, so the movie she likes it, so okay.
She's very much, I always talk about how much my son is like me to my ex-wife's chagrin. Uh-huh. But my daughter is also kind of turning into me where she's really into wanting to study psychology. Like, she's into the way, I'm going somewhere with this. She's into the way people think. She's into the way people behave the way that they do. But she also hates people and doesn't want to be around them.
Yeah, misanthrope.
Apple tree. But I get it. Also, for mental health professional who hates people. My point being, the movie, and first of all, I had to watch this movie twice. I took my kids on Friday. Passed the fuck out. And it was so funny because every time I woke up, Lady Raven was singing. And I'm like, does this ever stop? You know, so I missed large chunks of the movie, and I had to go back and watch it again on Sunday while her tropical storm Debbie was passing through Florida. my kids fucking love this movie. Like, this was again I saw the TV glow, where at the end I'd have no idea what I just watched, but my kids are just like, oh my God, Trap was the best movie ever. You know, and I'm glad that their first experience with M. Night Shyamalan was this and not like The Last Airbender or you know, like something like that.
Oh God, yeah.
So as for what I thought of it when I finally saw it a second time, I would say the star of this movie is the use of tension.
Yeah, there's tension for sure.
Oh, nice. Yeah, no, I like that.
They established right at the beginning, and I think there was an interview with M. Night Shyamalan and Ding Dong that talked about why he does the reveal at the beginning. because when you know that he's the butcher and that he's having an interaction with, you know, random fat black comic number 70 and he's having an interaction with Lady Raven, and then there's the reveal to her, then there's the car ride, then there's all the shit in the house and everything leading up to her being in the bathroom, and then after that finally the movie goes kaboom.
Okay.
We don't spoil movies here.
Fuck, sorry. My point being
here. Damn it. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go.
So anyway, there's a lot of building up of tension until the final, until the explosion that leads into, like, you know, the third act. Uh-huh. And that's the best part of the movie for me. I mean, there's great performances. I mean, the kid that plays Lady Raven, she's fine doing what she's doing because she's absolutely believable as a half brain dead tart singer, which is fine, which is what you wanted her to be.
Wow.
And, you know, and the kid, and the kid's believable as, you know, goofy. My favorite part of the movie is, why do you keep leaving? What's wrong with you? Yeah, like, we're supposed to be having daddy daughter time.
I was like, do you have diarrhea? What's the deal, dude? But because I've done that, did that in Sweetwater.
I like that they pointed that out too. I like that the daughter pointed out that he kept leaving.
Right.
And because I was like, you know, like, you see it so many times in movies where people are gone and nobody's like, hey, what's up? And they never like point out. I love the fact that I love the smart. I love the character that Josh is playing.
Yeah.
I like what he did and stuff like that. Let's not get that wrong.
I told my daughter, I was like, if you like the character that Josh Hartnett played in this movie, go watch all three seasons of Hannibal.
Yeah.
Hannibal did a really great job of showing, you know, serial killers that are not, you know, they're not all like, you know, Beta Ray Bill or whatever the fuck is, the Buffalo Bill. You know, they're not all like that. Some of them perfectly normal people that just have this other side to them. I like the fact that M. Night Shyamalan plays with that, where Josh Hartnett has these two worlds. He talked about, like, the duality of man, essentially, with this movie. It's such a weird thing, because there's a lot to talk about with Trap, and I know we don't have that much time, but it's a lot deeper, and there's a lot more to it than I think people are giving credit to, because they're focusing on stuff like the concert, you know, that never ended, things like that, and also because it's up against Deadpool, so that's getting all the attention. But Trap's a really good movie. Again, the effective use of tension, the speaking to the duality of man, where you have this character who is very much a dedicated father. I mean, it was nice to see.
Very interesting. You've seen stuff with that Henry Porter, so silly killer, but you never seen it quite like this when it comes to like you know, a loving father, a normal person,
right?
But you know, the whole time, really right front, that he's a bad person. Or he has
and that's the thing. It's just like he's not saying that, he's not selling it like, oh my god, like I'm evil and must murder people. Mm-hmm. He's like, I just have this thing inside of me. I gotta occasionally kill a person.
There was some,
you know, chop him up or whatever.
And then I gotta go back
to being normal again.
I have a thought on that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Go for it.
So, by putting his daughter in this movie, is M. Night actually Josh Hartnett, where he has this bad thing he likes to do, like shitty movies, but he's trying to make it up to his daughter by putting her in one of them?
I don't think he knows he's making a shitty movie when he does it.
The thing is, there were some parts in this where I was like, I'm not going to try it anyway. But there were parts of that, like the third act went off the fucking rails. Like, I'm like, god fucking damn, really? And I remember, I saw this with friends, and we sat there after, stood there in the lobby after the movie, tearing shit apart. That was like, okay, it's campy. That we had to put that right front, kind of campy. So
you want me to?
No, we're not.
I got a big tear apart. I got a big tear apart on this fucking movie. You ready for that?
Hold on, but 1 second.
Yeah.
I had to look past that to enjoy the movie itself, because that's what it is. It's campy. It's fun. It's a fun movie. But that third act, I had to pee so bad. And I was like, oh, that's the twist I get? That's why I nearly pissed myself in the theater? That's what happened?
The twist is bladder infection.
Yeah. So.
All right. I got a major one. Okay. That bugged the fucking living shit out of me during this entire movie. Okay. Oh, wow. Man, with my Bell palsy, I kind of go like fucking Stallone.
I didn't even notice it today, dude. I didn't even notice your Bell's palsy.
No. I've been doing exercises all week long to get everything back. I've been sleeping with ice masks on and stuff. But anyway, How can you say this movie is in Philadelphia?
Yeah.
When nothing you filmed was from Philadelphia.
Yeah, I really the thought entire, that. How is that the, not the Long Island Railroad in Madison Square Garden?
Yeah, like I was, no, it was Toronto. They filled it outside the Air Center. It used to be the Air Canada Center. I know, because I was there for WrestleMania 18. But like the Philadelphia, like almost 300,000 people were in Philadelphia for WrestleMania time, bro. And you just like said, this is downtown Philly. No, it wasn't.
Like, but, yeah, you got to show the Rocky statue, people getting cheesesteaks, or like it might as well have been in an imaginary big city. It might as well have been in Metropolis.
But Neil, it was, I didn't know that, but someone told me I would believe it, but it's just the
arena.
But Neil, you were there last fucking what year? Last 6 months?
April,
whatever.
4 months ago.
Okay, whatever. What the fuck? Not everyone was in Philly four months ago. Okay, so like I'm just saying.
I know, but like this is okay to do in the 1970s and 80s and 90s, maybe even the 90s. But this day and age, man, you can't film something in a different location.
Didn't
you
see the fact
this is?
Didn't we just see the fact that?
Philly doesn't have a downtown arena.
Okay, but listen.
Its arenas are all in the same place, just like how, I guess Kansas City just has a downtown arena. Kansas City has the Arrowhead out in the middle of nowhere.
I got you.
Same thing with Philly.
Okay, but listen.
And so it's like, there's no downtown arena. It just makes me weird.
But then I see the fact that it said, I'm not showing one finance this thing. So he's going to try to do the cheapest way in Toronto where you get, a fucking credit for a filming in Canada.
He could have showed up at WrestleMania. Nobody would have gave a fuck. They would have thought he was camera crew at WWE. Right.
I get what you're saying, Chris. Like, if they're going to film it in Toronto, Philadelphia is a very distinct looking city. If you're going to say it's downtown somewhere, then make it downtown St. fucking Louis or something. Okay. Because Philadelphia is way too distinctive.
Okay.
I just want to say this. You used the clip before of Alison Pill and Picard, and I'll never forgive you for it. But if you, but Alison Pill was great in the newsroom because that's where she belongs.
It's a great movie. Great show. Yes. Go on.
That's how I got to Memphis. Newsroom is fantastic, and she's really good in it. The conversation she has, again, I can't talk about it because you guys have weird rules.
Yeah,
but the conversation she has with Josh Hartnett in the third act of the movie is one of the best parts of the movie. It's very well acted. It's very much staged like a one-act, two-person play, and that conversation, it's a great demonstration of how you write a conversation that moves the plot forward, as opposed to The Acolyte, where people just talk endlessly and say nothing, but it sounds pretty. Can you tell I just watched The Acolyte today?
I didn't watch The Acolyte, so I can't tell you.
I watched Batman Cape Crusader, but it's done by Bruce Timm, who did the animated series.
He's just fucking 11 years old.
And Reeves. Right. Oh, dude, no. Oh, my God. It's so great.
My God, you and Alexis should go fucking bowling together.
It's 1960s, like, noir Batman. Oh, it's awesome. It's awesome.
Yeah, what do you think of the gender swap penguin?
That was awesome. I loved it. Me and my wife both watched it and we were like, dude, this is cool. Like, I'm not one of those people who are like, if you do it for a reason and they did it for a story, which made part of the story, then I'm down for it. I don't give a shit. Like, it's not my creation. I'm not the guy that created it. I'm here just to watch it.
Okay. I've heard it's very good. I pick on Alexis, but apparently Cape Crusader got rave reviews. Anyway, back to Trap. I think it's one of his better movies. I actually really enjoyed it the second time I watched it. My kids loved it. They were like, what I was getting to before was my daughter was like, I just want to know how he thinks. Like, I'm amazed at she's just going on and on and on about how his brain works. And then, you know, my son's whole thing, like, he really got into like the tension of the movie, how things built. And then it's not a twist ending in the end, like in the typical M. Night Shyamalan fashion, but he does something at the end of the movie and you're just like, oh, that's creepy.
I know exactly what you're talking about. Also, I'm going to agree with you on this. Even though we make fun of like the over fact that he's 100% shoving his daughter's face right into ours the entire movie.
I mean,
to be honest, it did actually make it feel like it was a concert. It did actually make it like that. Maybe I'm over I don't know what the word would be, but like I just now realized that maybe even finishing the songs in certain part, maybe not in the third act, the song there that got finished, they could have cut that a little bit or whatever. But besides that, like the concert itself actually kind of makes more sense in a little bit, where it, because it's not rushing things and it's trying to make it like the full length of a concert.
Like I said, the I understand why the concert got on everyone's nerves, but I think it was needed because of the kind of movie it was. Remember, without giving too much away, they know the cops know he's going to be there, yeah. And they are it's the whole point of the movie. They are trying to set a trap for him, and when he realizes it, he has to then do a bunch of stuff to get out
of it,
which
was crazy and cool.
Yeah, and the whole thing is like, how is he going to do it? How is he going to escape this concert? You guys, I mean, I don't think Neil's ever been to a concert, but I'm pretty sure Chris has. you know how hard it is to move her. You know how hard it is things to move around? Like, you
Unless you got VIP, like, if you got the
and
radio.
There's guards, but there's security everywhere, and they are watching, and they will, you know, they check your ID. Like, it's not easy to maneuver around these places, and if you look out, and the staff that's there, they know who's supposed to be there. So, if you know, him doing what he does and getting away with it, like, you know, it's creepy. It's pretty cool because normally that wouldn't happen. So as much as like, oh my God, another 20 minutes of her singing. Okay, sure. But you need that entire first act and a half to tell that part of the story.
In the pantheon of in that Shyamalan film. You want to say something real quick?
Mm-hmm.
You want to say something real quick?
Well, what I was going to say too is, a thing I thought I had was the fact that how M. Night, usually when he writes for people, he doesn't know how to write like actual human language. Like, you know, it sounds robotic doesn't sound like how people actually would speak. He's had that problem in a few films, and I'm not going to point him out now, but I think it actually worked kind of perfect for Josh Harnett, because it is a psychopath that is trying to teach himself how to, you know, speak human.
Is this the most that Night and Shyamalan actually had a role in the film? Like, he was in this for like a good 3 minutes of screen time, and Village Ending is for like 2 minutes. So I was like, oh, there's M. Night, he's gonna talk again. But
my favorite bit with his daughter is her in the bathroom, because one, she sounds like a moron, but she sounds exactly like a girl who is that character, would talk in that situation.
Yeah.
It was perfect. It's one of those things where it's like, where again, subjectively it's grating because I want to punch her right in the teeth. Objectively, it's perfect.
So in the pantheon of M. Night Shyamalan films, where does this sit for everyone here? Because to me, it's better than...
Oh, that's a good question.
It's better than Lady of the Water, better than The Happening.
Good
than,
question.
It's better than Lady of the Water. It's better than The Happening.
It's top one-third for me.
Okay. It's better than Lady of the Water. It's better than The Happening. Better than The Last Emperor After Earth. And I think I like The Visit a bit more, because I actually like The Visit quite a bit. I like Split quite a bit. I'm not the biggest fan of Glass. I don't know if anyone else really like Glass. It's better than
Glass. Glass was okay.
Better than Old. Right, it's better than like The Cabin, so it's like top.
Old was okay. Old was okay up until the end.
It's
speaking of multiple endings, like Lord of the Rings, that whole bit where they get off the island sucks. But everything up to them getting off the island, up to them getting off the island was good. I liked Old a lot.
Yeah,
I would say like it's not as good as like Signs or Sixth Sense or any of that. But it's I would say it's top one third Shyamalan.
Neil, where are you on this?
Man, I'm looking it over right now because I love Sixth Sense. I like Signs. I'm a big fan of Signs.
Yeah, Signs is good.
Unbreakable, Glass, and Split. Man, I really like Split.
Yeah,
I'm not
great.
Gonna lie, Split
Split's
is really one good. Of my faves. But besides A Knock at the Cabin, I was a huge fan of Knock at the Cabin.
The ending was a big
I even have a Knock at the Cabin.
I would have liked that more if I hadn't seen the preview, because the preview gave everything away. So the acting was really good.
I think we were lukewarm on Knock at the Cabin. Like, it was efficient, it was serviceable, it wasn't great.
Yeah. It was better.
But it's beautiful to see the Batista all the time.
Sure.
Anyway.
My thing about The Visit, by the way, is when The Visit came out, is they didn't do none of the marketing mentioned M. Night at all, because he was just fucking pariah. They're like, you put out the airbender, you put out fucking After Earth. No one gives a fuck about him anymore. But then after Visit, they're like, oh, he people like him again. So, let's
and then Shyamalan is back.
Yeah, basically.
I mean, so out of 21 films, I would put it in like the top eight.
I'm looking forward to whatever he does next.
I have to argue each one back and forth to figure out what exactly that man. Maybe we should all just get together randomly on a Sunday and just like sit here and like do
Shyamalan
night Shyamalan list
of M. Night Shyamalan.
But I like Trap. It's campy and fun, but it's not amazing. But it's a fun movie, and I'm looking forward to what he does next.
Well, let's do it. What's the scores, guys?
What's your score? You go first. You go first, Neil.
I'll be more than happy to go first. I actually really like this movie, even though, like, you know, we got shoved in the face a lot from, you know, that, you know, M. Night Shyamalan is got a daughter and she sings for a living.
She's so pretty.
And you know, that she wants us to know that she's a singer, and we all know that she's around all the time. And anyway, but I'm definitely going to give it, I think I'm going to give it like a 3.8. I really liked it. I was, you know, I like Josh Hartnett. Like, I love the way he acted as a serial killer. I think the way that, again, I believe the way that M. Night writes worked perfect for a serial killer. Maybe he should just write for serial killers in movies from now on.
Maybe not.
But, you know, I think this is one of his better ones, so I'm down for it.
All right, Mark, what do you feel about this movie? What's your score on this one?
It's better than The Last Airbender and worse than The Sixth Sense. That's my score.
Okay. My scores are... I want to mention that Mark Winfrey, he actually did do the score perfect, even though I encouraged him not to. So he was... because...
I listened to the review. Yeah. He and Robert's a rule follower. That's why we work well together.
He's a sweetheart.
Yes.
But my score on this is right behind Neil. It's a 3.7. I like this movie. It's not bad. My wife really wants to see it. She wants to, but she had prior engagements. I'm on RuntMans.com. What is Neil? What is the audience score for Trap?
The audience score for Trap would definitely have to be, I'm going to guess, 71%.
65%. Whatever.
Damn.
Neil was a creek score for Trap.
It must be from Texas. What? 82%.
54%. 54.
Jesus Christ, dude. What the fuck, guys? Be nice to the guy.
Creek consensus is, Narch Thrower were given some grounding by Josh Hartnett's committed performance. Shyamalan Ding Dong's Trap will snare those who appreciate his tongue-in-cheek style, while the rest of it... The rest of you out from it. I read a bad review and a review because that's what I do now.
You're welcome.
I'm going to do a different one. I want to see the fat guy who moves at this one. I don't know if he did. This is from Olivia Yark of Hollywood Reporter. She says, the film is a concert movie for Shyamalan's daughter, musician Salika, wrapped in a middling thriller kept afloat by compelling performance in Josh Hartnett. Okay. And this is from Nicholas Bell at Fish Jelly Films. He says, although it never has a tendency to test the logical restraints of the scenario, Shyamalan's latest is an enjoyable tense game of fractured cat and mouse led by malevolent Josh Hartnett. And I think we all said, like Neil said, that Josh Hartnett is the anchor of this movie. And he's good. I'm glad to see him in stuff again. You know?
I like to see that he's coming back a lot too. I like to see Josh. I like Josh. I mean, I love him in Sin City. I love him in one of my favorite movies of all time, even though they get much love in the world, is Lucky Number 11. Mm. And yeah, like that is just one of my, with Sir Ben Kingsley, freaking Morgan Freeman, Lucy Liu, like stuff like that is one of my favorite. That's like an Ocean's 11, Boondock Saints. Like that's one of those movies I can just like throw on and enjoy. And 30 Days of Night, I think, is still one of the best vampire fucking movies in the history of vampires. Period.
Okay, me top 20. But this is, you guys can find Trap on
top 20. What fucking 18 movies beat fucking 30 Days of Night?
Lots of them. But this is true.
What the fuck?
No, I did, dude, listen, I like 30s anyway, but say it's in the top right, 20.
I forgot you like your vampires that twinkle. Anyway, go ahead.
I don't, but yeah, you guys can see this at theaters, I'm sure, in streaming. I don't know how it's doing with the box office, but I imagine it'll be there next couple weeks, maybe, and maybe a week from now, 2 months from now, who knows. But try out PS in theaters. It's worth watching if you guys like silly, fun movies. And you guys know a little bit of Shyamalan. If you guys know a little bit of them, the twist won't be as extreme as you there, I think, but it's there, and it's fun, it's campy, and I recommend it. Right?
Yes, good movie. Watch it. If you don't, Mark will come to your house and stay the night. And
well, may I want to? May
I am a lovely guest. That's not a threat.
I imagine Mark comes over and let's tell you what's
even
there.
This is the room you'd stay in, Mark. Yeah, again, this is the room you'd stay in. There's a bed right here. There's a closet so you can hang up your
I
stuff.
I clean up after
the
myself.
The bathroom's right across the hallway. You have your own kind of private space. I make it so it's like just, you can watch TV on this, I'll put a TV in the corner.
Neil's guest bed is actually fantastic. My wife has stayed there several times.
It's a pillow top featherhead with, queen size.
Yeah,
it's
very comfortable. I mean, I sit there like a baby every time I go there. I wake up and then Neil's
so
like,
many people have made babies on it. It's awesome. There's this one stain I can't get out.
I came out one day. It was like 11 a.m. and Neil handed me a beer. And I'm like, all right, let's do this. You guys can find us online, moviesdontsuck.net, where at WTMnet.com, so you know to do. MSMUsNet.com, you'll find us there. On a bunch of really cool podcasts that Mark is part of, when it comes to. You go there and say,
oh, hi, Mark.
And then you can find us on Instagram at NGS Podcast, or on X NGS Podcast. We're on YouTube at Movies Don't Suck Podcast. We're on Patreon, Patreon.com/MoviesDontSuck. Find some bonfire situations that suck and something new. You'll find shirts. Go to TeePublic at Blackwood Productions. You'll find where something else made and our shirts there. Different styles, that sort of thing. And where you find podcasts on movies that suck something new. Like us, subscribe, all that shit that people do when they talk about hawking their podcast. Mark, where can people find you?
I am at Mark Rattledge on TikTok. You'll find 10 to 30 minute clips of any one of my podcasts, including the ones I'm on this one when they actually send me the video.
Yeah.
you'll find clips of my kids doing funny skits. You will find, hey, so Jesse and I have embraced artificial intelligence, our AI generated music. We are currently working on, we've got two songs already for Rattledge and Broadcasting, the album. We did the on trial theme and song. We did a song called More Dinosaurs, which is something I said on Long Road to Ruin once. So every other month or so, Jesse and I get together and we make a song using artificial intelligence and ChatGPT.
Sounds awesome.
Fantastic. Yeah. Having a good time with that. So all those songs and whatever else we did, I used artificial intelligence to write a song about my wife, my ex-wife. That's fun. That's on my TikTok as well. It's not complimentary.
Give me the link to the AI we got to use for that. I want to do one about my ex-wife.
Oh my god, it's so therapeutic. Anyway, for stuff not about my ex-wife, you can check out w2mnetwork.com on YouTube, or w2mnetwork.com on Twitch, or w2mnetwork. And for the traditional audio stuff, it's Rattledge and Broadcasting on Spotify, Apple Music, or wherever you listen to your podcasts.
All right, Neil, what is your small business?
If you got a small business, let us help you out. We'll be more than happy to advertise you right here to our thousands of followers, our millions of listeners, right here on Movies That Don't Suck and Some That Do.
You guys ready to get out of here?
The Acolyte sucks.
All right.
I can't think of anything now. The fucker just fucked me up with the fucking thing he just fucking said all the fucking time, man. All right, restart. All right, here we go. 5, 4. I don't even know. Okay, what are we doing? All right. All right, got it. Let's go. That's another episode of Movies Don't Suck and Some Do. My name's Neil.
And I'm Chris.
I'm Mark.
And remember, guys, anytime she tries to tell you just do it back in the back, she's probably getting you in a trap. Have a good day.